It's a great honor for me to be here this evening at the inauguration of this research conference. I had the honor some time ago, at least for a very short time, to be the Minister of Higher Education. And one of the objectives that Mohan and I tried to pursue was to encourage more and more research in our universities. So I'm very happy that on this occasion, many of the graduates, Sri Lankan graduates and their Japanese counterparts, are presenting papers for discussion. Today I just want to make a few observations regarding the relationship between Sri Lanka and Japan. Japan has always been a great friend of Sri Lanka, and we have looked upon Japan as a role model, because Japan was the first country to industrialize herself in this region and thereby become a world power. Today there are many world powers from our region, but it is an indisputed fact that Japan was the very first Asian country to achieve the status of a world power. Now there are good sides and bad sides to being a world power, but in Sri Lanka we have always benefited from the good side. All our leaders have looked to Japan to find solutions to some of our problems. And it is right to say that we have not absorbed those lessons as much as we should have. And even today, we can look at developments in Japan and assess how we can absorb more and more of those very important pioneering ventures. If you look at the development history of Japan, education becomes the key. I think it was in the Meiji Restoration, that is about 1860s and after, that Japan, which was close to the world, began to open herself to international contacts and opened herself in such a way that it paved the way for rapid economic growth and industrialization. Now the first thing that strikes us as distinct from the Edo period, which preceded it, is the total commitment and the more democratic system in Japan, which led to an expansion of education. Now it's very interesting to see that while South Asia, many of those countries were part of the British colonial system, but Japan had the good fortune to establish open links with the educational and cultural patterns of the United States. So right from the beginning, when you analyze the educational systems, you will find that we in South Asia were very much involved in the British system of higher education, while the Japanese, following the United States, had a much more practical and results-oriented type of education. So it was this bifurcation, I think, that helped Japan to industrialize and also to become a model for the type of development that we are aspiring. Because today we know that the traditional British model of education, which high emphasis on the humanities, there's a big debate. What is the role of humanities? What is the role of scientific education and so on, but I think that universal acceptance that this humanities based educational system may have very good aspects in human development, but as fast as economic growth is concerned, and fast economic growth is concerned, is probably not the best model to follow. Whereas if you look at the Japanese system of education, where they adopted the three-tier model of the American university system, it has yielded many more results. I was looking at some of the reports on Japanese education, and let me read a part of that. In 1871, the Ministry of Education was established as a part of the central government. America was the model for the school system, which consisted of three levels of schooling: elementary school, middle school, and university. So that the traditional Japanese system of education was transformed pretty rapidly into this three-tier type of education. And in this, the new education system not only adopted foreign curricula, foreign methods of teaching, basically American, it also encouraged a lot of foreign teachers. According to this report, initially they allowed a lot of foreign teachers, particularly language teachers, to come and transform the educational system. And they also, these are lessons that we can have, hosted a large number of Japanese who had studied abroad, who had acquired Western knowledge and were willing to come back and enter the Japanese educational system. So in a short time, the system, educational system in Japan was transformed and became the basis for the scientific endeavors and industrialization that took place soon after. So the first lesson we can get from the Japanese experience is the priority given to education, the priority given to more and more practical elements of education, priority given to science and technology. So this is an area which we can learn. Unfortunately, it has some good sides also, but basically the traditional educational system we had in Sri Lanka, and which we even perpetuate to this day. If you look at the university intakes, still a large slice of the people who come into the university system, I think this year or next year we are hoping to have something like 25,000 students coming in as undergraduates to the university system. Of them, I think a large slice, very large slice, I would even say a disproportionate slice of it, is still going into that British type of humanities education. So there is a fundamental issue regarding growth and education which Sri Lankan authorities have to address. It's not an easy issue, because the university intake is really a culmination of a whole educational process. You can't just lop off at the top, because that will be very unfair and lead to a lot of social distress. But the fact of the matter is that unlike the Japanese education system, the Sri Lankan education system is still not technology oriented, science oriented, and not enough of a thrust towards industrial and economic growth. Now that's one problem that we have to look at. This is well seen by some of the statistics that I was able to obtain regarding the number of institutions. Now, for example, if you look at the number of institutions, higher education institutions in Japan from the years 1955 to 1990, the number of universities have grown from 228 in 1955 to 507 in 1990. I mean, the These are the figures that I have, maybe the new figures are even more dramatic. Then look at the junior colleges. From 1955, it had 264 junior colleges. It has gone up to 593 by 1990. And most important, colleges of technology. In 1955, there was not a single college of technology. But today, or in 1990, it has gone up to 62. So step by step, the teachings in technology have expanded very fast, both through junior colleges and colleges of technology, as well as the science and other departments of the university system. So it is very clear that the higher education system is growing in Japan, but growing in that direction of science and technology. There may be a debate, sometimes you read of it, even in Japan, saying that we have become very mechanical men, we don't have enough time for the arts and so on. That debate is there, that is a good debate. But the fact of the matter is that the background, the institutional background for economic growth is being established in the Japanese education system, something that we are looking forward to going towards but still have not achieved. Now the second thing that we can deduce from this university, from especially the junior colleges and colleges of technology, is the approach to innovation. If you look at the history of Japanese industrial growth, you can find small entrepreneurs, middle-level entrepreneurs after the war, through experience and technology, have been able to reach the highest levels of sophistication. If you look at, for example, Mr. Honda and many other people who were almost mechanics, who started with one motorcycle or one car or one piece of technology, over a period of time, they have been developing that technology, patenting that technology, bringing towards them all sorts of other scientific expertise, and today are global leaders in that type of product. Most of the top Japanese products, I think I'm not wrong in saying that many of the big names, Yamasaki or Honda or Mitsui or whatever maybe, they really started, and they even today carry the names of their founders, who started small, but were able to use this environment and culture to develop this. So that is another aspect, the role of small and medium scale entrepreneurs in Japan is something that we can learn very much. But the Japanese system, I'm talking to the converted, you know much more about this than I do, I only read, you have lived there, is this zaibatsu system, where small entrepreneurs are picked up by large conglomerates. Now if you go to see Ito in Colombo, now it's Itochu, or if you go to Mitsui, or if you go to Mitsubishi, they will put you in touch with some producer in Japan with whom they have contact, but they are not really the producers of that. I can give you a wonderful example. In my own electorate, there were some guys who wanted to set up a more sophisticated sawmill. They wanted these electric saws. So luckily I knew the Japanese companies here, and I took him. He was a village businessman. I took him to, at that time, see Ito. Now it's Itochu, because they were the chairman of Itochu at that time, a very distinguished and a very dear friend of Sri Lanka. He was a national hero in Japan. So Itochu, when I took my person and said he wants to buy a big saw, a more modern saw for timber, because he was a sawmill owner, Itochu didn't say, well, we have nothing to do with this, to take him to another company. That poor guy would have been shown the door, saying, well, we have nothing to do with this, this is not. But this huge company of Itochu said, no, we will find a partner for you. The type of Japanese company, middle level company or a small company that is manufacturing this saw, and Hitachi will make sure that this company will compete. So that is the Zaibatsu system, where the mega companies also function as sponsors and also as a support organization for lots of small entrepreneurs. Now this is something that we can learn. In Sri Lanka, can you honestly say that a middle level entrepreneur can go to a big company and say, I want this, find me a partner or find me some equipment? We have not reached that stage, but it is a necessary stage in industrial development. So that is a lesson that we can learn very much from Japan. And today, this is a lesson which we must always emphasize. Look at the technology that at the ground level that operates. If you take garages, for example, they have no training. They first come as a small kolla, you know, an assistant to the garage owner. And I know for a fact, because once I did a little sociological study, that fellow for the first 6 months, he has nothing to do. He has to take a empty orange barley bottle and bring tea from the boutique for the Pasuna and his senior staff. So he does that for 6 months. Then he's allowed to handle some small job like that. So all the training is on the job training in that workplace. But today, are we having people who can replace that guy who probably ended up as a big Basuna owner later on? I was amused. Now, who are the morticians in the big companies who run these funeral parlors? They are the guys who started cutting up people as employees of a bigger company. So they learn only on the job. Even morticians have to learn it as laborers who start cutting up bodies. There's no type of support knowledge that they can use. So that is a very clear sign of very low level or primitive industrial development. So these are areas where I think we can get a lot of assistance from Japan and a lot of examples of how Japan is moving forward in a model which is not usually available in the West. Now, when those days when we studied management, you studied how an American company will work. You know, the studies of the shop floor, not just the steward. And strangely enough, the lesson was in the American shop floor, don't work too hard. The guy who worked hard was given a hard time, because very soon they set up a norm. You know, you have to do only 3 units per day. But actually that fellow can do 5 units. And if he tries to do 5 units, the whole trade union and the whole shop floor is against him, because they want to keep that norm. I'm just reporting to you sociological studies. The guy who wants to work more is made to be an outsider, the guy who can't fit in. Now, that model, that is the idea of the Weberian bureaucracy, for example, or Peter Bloor's study of management and bureaucracy, was completely overturned by the Japanese. They may not be doing it now because of the economic downturn and all that. But there was a time when a worker in a Japanese factory could think that his son will find a job in that company. He's a Mitsui man. His father was a Mitsui man. His grandfather was a Mitsui man. Or he will be a Mitsubishi lady. She'll find a job in Mitsubishi. So that, and they would all come and salute the flag and wear the Mitsubishi t-shirt and all that. So that was a different model of management and productivity from the American system, where the Americans say, no, you can't. The trade union says you can't go beyond that. And I have a feeling that even our trade unions are following more the American model. I may not be correct, but I have a sneaky feeling that we are following the American model. Always follow the least work model. If there's less work in Japan, we'll follow that model. But it so happens that in the Japanese case, they clearly talked about the higher productivity. And then, of course, the Toyota method. where they linked productivity, didn't shift workers around, and each worker had a norm. So we can learn a lot. I don't know whether we are even learning those lessons from the great management exchanges, the management experiments that have made Japanese companies world leaders. I must also say these are constantly changing. I mean, I don't think, for example, this classical Japanese style of, you know, your son and grandson all coming into the company, whether it can be maintained now, of layoffs and economic competition and declining economies, it may not be possible. But the fact is that those are very important alternate models of management, which we should have looked into and which we have not done enough. And this is a tremendous challenge and a tremendous opportunity to our management and other faculties in the universities to, well, I won't say you can replace, but give another possible alternative regarding business management, factory management, and so on. And my, I was the Minister of Investment for a long time. Some of my friends are all here, they have worked in Japanese companies. I must say they have a lot of respect for Sri Lankan workers, especially our middle management, because our workers are quicker to learn another language, quicker to read those manuals, quicker to follow those steps that have to be taken. For example, one of my Japanese investor friends told me, now he had plants in Indonesia, he had plants in Thailand, in Philippines. He said, only in Sri Lanka, we don't have to fly in the middleman. Because our guys learn this and they can do it by themselves. But if it's in Thailand or Philippines, we have to send another person from Japan to do that middle management role, which means, of course, that they have to pay more, and in a highly cost-cutting environment, we are still very competitive. So these are, I just gave only a few examples to whet your appetite, to show that there's a lot of work that we can do. The whole management sector in our big corporates, and particularly the public corporations. Why don't we try the Japanese system? Now look at the dockyards, Ceylon dockyards, which has Japanese management, Japanese investment. It's very productive. You are wherever, then you look at Noritake. How are they productive? How are the Japanese companies here productive and competitive? Because today in the corporate world, however much you like a country or like the people, you can't go on taking losses. If you go on taking losses, they'll just shut down your plant. That's it. There's no sentimental road. They may have worked for 30 years, but if for 4 or 5 years you go on losing money and your cost of production makes it impossible, you just shut you down. That's all. So there's no sentiment. So we have to be always ahead of the game. We have to be productive and make sure that today the cost of production. I'm very worried in Sri Lanka, many of our enterprises, the COP is going up. We are losing that competitive edge. So that can come, that can be, the countervailing to that is better management, better discipline, and higher productivity. So that's the lesson that we have, the problem that we have. And I think Japan gives us a wonderful lesson, because they are constantly innovating. Something that worked, this, say the Toyota method, you try it, if you fail, they'll try some other method. So, of course, they are a bigger economy, but I think this research meeting will show us that we have to examine the Japanese example of growth, the Japanese example of productivity, and see that we improve a very sluggish corporate sector is better, but the public sector is extremely sluggish, and it really needs a good dose of Japanese sake. Thank you very much.